Okay. So, hey guys, welcome to this talk on Software Zero Day Discovery, a journey from main to return. My name is Kushal Arvind Shah, and So who am I? I'm a senior security researcher at Fortinet's FortiGuard Labs. My research interests are fuzzing, zero day discovery, whether be it some softwares, libraries, or any firmwares, pen testing and forensics. Basically anything to do with security except for compliance. So I've found zero-day vulnerabilities in most of the big vendors and products that you use today. Microsoft, Google, Adobe, Cisco, Intel, Samsung, etc. I'm a research alumni. I'm an alumni from RIT, Rochester Institute of Technology, and you can reach me on Twitter at @KushZeroZone. So, yeah. So why this talk? Well, I was able to discover numerous vulnerabilities in popular products over the last 5+ years. Since I joined Fortinet. And I noticed that despite huge advancements in technologies and softwares, zero days are widely prevalent in everything we use and everywhere we look. You find vulnerabilities every now and then. So like I felt it was a time like, you know, I could share some insight as to how you find zero days, right from what target to select, where do you find inputs, and what fuzzes to use, what tricks to use, and how do you get the end result. Because I've seen many talks focusing only on a particular deep dive into one bug or sharing some new fuzzer that people wrote, but no one explains as to how do you go about the whole process. So if you were to follow this talk, that might help you in your pursuit of finding a zero-day vulnerability. So today's agenda, you have, so what is a zero-day? How do you find zero-day vulnerabilities? Recently disclosed zero-day bugs and their POCs. Which targets to select, how do we build or use them, how to find and build corpus for the selected targets, a little bit of intro on the common methods that we use, like fuzzing. And lastly, I'll be showing you how do you find critical bugs in popular products by not fuzzing or reversing. Basically, you're doing nothing and you find a vulnerability. So, yeah, so let's go ahead. So what is a zero-day vulnerability? It's basically in a layman's lingo, it is a vulnerability that no one knows about, or malicious actors are knowing about it and are exploiting it, but basically the developer doesn't know about it. So it's not being fixed. That's the easiest way to go about it. And sometimes some researchers are also sitting on zero days, and that's why it's not being fixed. So, it can be in softwares, firmwares, hardware, or open source libraries. It can be anywhere. So where do we find recent zero-day vulnerabilities and their POCs? Some vendors publish zero-day vulnerability details, some don't. Unfortunately, that's the way it is. So several open source bug trackers provide vulnerabilities and POCs. That's one place you can look forward to that. Several researchers publish zero-day bugs on their blogs or on GitHub repositories. And you have description, reproduction steps, and you also have POCs. So you can test that against older versions, against the unfixed versions. So let's see where we can find those. One common place for Chrome-related vulnerabilities is the Chromium Bug Tracker. So if you just go to crbug.com and you search for, as you can see in the image, reward, and it will show you all the vulnerabilities that have been reported by external researchers like myself and others, and which have been fixed and which have been rewarded by Google. So you can find, you can open up each of these and you'll most probably find the description, the reproduction, and mainly the POC files. So over here you can see ZDICAN, that's a zero-day initiative. And you can see all the ZDICAN reports which have been reported. And you can see also that there is a recent one also, CVE-2020. And you can find the POCs in them also. So that's one place to, you know, you can get those reports. Apart from that, Google also maintains several open source projects like LibAngle, WebP, WebM, Skia, PDFM. Some are engines which they, you know, which are imbibed into the Chrome browser and the Chromium OS. And some are formats like, some are repositories for file formats like WebP and WebM. So you can find bugs in them also. Most of these bugs are not making it to the Chrome bug tracker, but they are a good place to look for seeds and if you want to, if you're interested in fuzzing and finding bugs. So over here, you can see PDFM. The project is PDFM project, and you can see the crash.pdf file, which is easily available freely to anyone. And you can't, and also the version is mentioned. So if you are able to get an older build of Chrome, which they provide, you can test it on that and you can see how it works and all that. And you can also add it to your seed files if you are interested in fuzzing the current version. Similarly, over here, you can see the Skia engine. That is a 2D, 3D layout engine that Google has built. And you can find a vulnerability over here where you also have the POC. So you can download these two. So these are like, apart from these, like I showed before, there are other projects also where you can download POCs and vulnerabilities that have been reported by external researchers and also by Google researchers or Google developers. So apart from that, you can also find zero-day bugs, like I mentioned before, on GitHub. And this is one GitHub repository where you can see there are bugs for all the JavaScript engines. You have Chakra for Microsoft Edge. You have JSC for another browser. You have JScript for JScript that is in Windows. You have V8, that is the Google Chrome V8 engine. So you have all the vulnerabilities that different researchers have reported, and it has been accumulated over here, and you can get the POCs directly with the vulnerability descriptions for some of them. This is for all the some of the ZDI vulnerabilities that have been reported, have been fixed, and you can get POCs for them. So apart from that, so that is basically finding recent zero-day vulnerabilities and their POCs. But how do you go about selecting a target? Which target, which product should I find a zero-day in? Is that something of interest? Is that something that other researchers are also looking into? Will I spend, if I spend a lot of time, then only I can get a vulnerability? Or if I just spend a day or two and I find like 10 bugs? So for that, you can look at different ways to select that. So the first thing that comes to mind is looking at the big security players. So let's see that. So here you have ZDI, you have all the zero-day initiative advisories, and you can see products over here, Honor Automation, that's a SCADA product. You have Adobe Acrobat, and you have Microsoft and all also. So if you just go to the website, you will find tons of them. You'll find the company, the product, and the file format many a times. So you can test those. This over here, you have Cisco Talos. So Talos also provides you their own set of advisories. You can select the targets from there. Flexera or Secunia is another place where you can select your targets and you can find vulnerabilities based off that. And you also have the Fortinet's FortiGuard Labs, which you can use for identifying which targets the companies are interested in, which targets they have recently tested and they have found vulnerabilities in. Zerodium is another. So those were the big security players. Apart from that, there are vulnerability brokers or exploit brokers like Zerodium. So they also publish a list of applications, list of operating systems or products or firmwares or devices that they are interested in. And if you have a vulnerability or if you have an exploit for them, you can share it with them also. So basically, it's something that's of interest to those guys. So apart from that, should you select only what others are focusing on, or you can think of something else also, something that others are not looking into, others have not heavily tested, and chances for you to find a vulnerability will be very high. So if you remember, there was recently a vulnerability in the Google Chromebook in the C-Aries DNS library. So the researcher just found that and he reported it responsibly to Google. Google paid him $100,000. And that is something that none of the big vendors were looking into. But this guy, he found it and he got paid for it. So that's definitely something significant. Also, apart from this, Facebook, WhatsApp also recently had a GIF-related vulnerability in the platform, in the application. And that was also an open source library, which was on GitHub. And some researchers just tried to test it and he found that. And yeah, so the impact was big. So these are other ways that you can look into what's behind the scenes, what's open source, or what's not heavily tested. And you can test those two. So apart from that, which other applications can you look into? So this website, it's called file-extensions.org. It's an amazing website. So over here, you can find information on all the file formats in existence, like 20, 30-year-old file formats, proprietary formats, open source formats, and all the prevalent ones. So you can find all formats. You can find which applications are able to open them, import them, view them, and that way you can identify. So this is over here. We have the graphics extensions, all the graphic-related file formats. And if we click on one of them in the next slide, I've just opened up CDR. So that's CorelDRAW-related file format. So over here, you if you like in the image, you can't see that, but if you go to this website and you open CDR, it will show you that CorelDRAW is able to open this format and it is able to view it and open it. But is that the only format supported by CorelDRAW? No, CorelDRAW supports all of these formats. And just because CDR is the default format that they came up with, that doesn't mean that that is the only one. And that most probably must be tested a lot, but not the other ones. So you can test any of these formats and chances are you'll find tons of bugs in them. So that was just CorelDRAW Graphics Suite, that application. But over this website also gives us information on other applications by that same company. So that same company has several other applications, and most of the times they support some formats which are like supported by four or five applications. So and most importantly, the parser that they use is same. The engine that they use is the same. So if you find a vulnerability in product A, there are high chances that it's going to be affecting product B, C, D, and E. So earlier, just by product A, you were impacting maybe a million users, but with product B, C, D, and E, you could overall impact 10 million users. So that way you can increase your scope as to, you know, which applications or which vendor and which products you want to focus on. So that was CorelDRAW. But then there are some formats these days people are attacking, you know, it's like cyber warfare and different countries are attacking different countries and all those things. So you have, if you're looking only for specific vulnerabilities in a specific geolocation, then you can also use this this website. So over here you can see HWP, that's Hangul Word Processor. So in South Korea, there's a language called Hangul, and they have their own suite like Microsoft Office. So HWP is the application that they use for that language, and you can test that too. So that way you can find lots of vulnerabilities in that. Similarly, if you just open up Google, so there are so many languages across the world, right? And each of them have their own processor, each of them have their own parser to understand that that language and all that. So if you just search on Google, you can search Japanese word processor and this application comes up, NJ Star. And sounds interesting. So that is something also we can look into. So these are the ways you can find applications. But the next thing is that are these targets that prominent? Is it worth spending our time into it? And is that product in active development? Will that vendor respond if we report some vulnerabilities to them or not? We don't know. So this website is called Owler.com. It gives you a lot of information on any domain. You just put in the website name and it will give you information about the revenue. Is it actively developed, in development, and who is the CEO and all those things. So over here we see it's a 28.6 million revenue company. And most often this data is like a year or two old. So it shows that it's at least in active development, and they might be interested in fixing vulnerabilities, and they might have a user base as well. Otherwise they won't be getting that revenue, right? So that is something that you can do. So that was just an obscure one. I'm also showing you Adobe over here. So Adobe also is listed over here. Any website, you name it, it's got it. And it's showing you 10.6, it's definitely more right now. But so Adobe is also there, and it will also show you competitors for each of the domains that you put in. And it will show you other websites or other products or other companies who are competitors to them. So that way you can identify even further, further identify more targets that you want to find vulnerabilities in their products or not. So that was identifying if the target is worth or not. Other thing that you can do is you can identify if the vulnerability is worth something or not. So this website is called VULDB.com. You just registered free registration and it will give you information on vulnerabilities that have already been, that are zero day, that have been fixed and all that. So let's say you found a bug in that NJSTAR application and but you don't know what, or you're thinking of trying to fuzz it, but you don't know if you should or not. So you can check that on this website and you'll find information on, let's say someone found a vulnerability 5 years back. It will tell you that what was the zero day value for that, what is the exploit value today. And that way that will help you if you want to pursue the target or not. So not just the company, the vendor, but also the vulnerability valuation. Because zero day will not be able to give you valuation for every exploit or every vulnerability, right? So this is one website which helps you do that. That was target selection. Moving on, we go to target building and usage. So you can, all softwares in the world, they are either two types, either they are open source or they're closed source. So for open source, you'll have to use some ways to build it. For closed source, you'll have to use some methods to assist your debugging. So let's check. So yeah. So for open source, you have different options like custom compiler. You can use AFL, AFL Smart, LibFuzzer, CLang, LLVM, or you can use your own compiler. There are tons of them. There are different things that you can use for compile time. You can enable sanitizers. Most common are address, memory, thread, and undefined. There are recent ones also like control flow integrity, which very few people talk about, but that also finds you a lot of vulnerabilities. And which hasn't been used a lot as well. So additional shared libraries, you can use libdislocator that's bundled with AFL. And you can also modify the source. So you have a heavy application and it takes up a lot of time to open the application, then load the file and then close. So you can modify and you can make it such that it will just be in a persistent, it won't close the application. You just feed the input files one after the other. So there are several things that you can do. Apart from that, that was compile time. Runtime options, relevant to whatever compile time options you've selected, you can select the appropriate runtime options as well. If you have sanitizers, you can use all the sanitizer related options as you can see here. If you have not enabled sanitizers, you can use Vilegrind. Vilegrind has a lot of other options like cache grind and memgrind and all those, but you can use those tools to debug the run for each fuzzing session for each file. So for closed source, there are two ways you can go about it, especially with WinAFL coming up lately. Before it was that people were just fuzzing the application directly and not the DLLs. So now with WinAFL, you can fuzz DLLs directly. You don't need to deal with the heavy application. So over here, you can see I've mentioned some of the DLLs and plugins that come built in with Photoshop. And some of them are self-explanatory, some of them are not. But if you just check the details and you can see which all formats it supports if you just reverse it. So JPEG 2000, it shows you that's JPEG 2000, directly the format is mentioned. DCOM is DCOM related. So there are tons of plugins and most of them are not heavily tested. So there are chances of you finding vulnerabilities that are plenty in them. And apart from that, you can, if you are directly fuzzing the application, you can just see what are the input or import functionalities it has, related formats for that. You can disable, that's basically common sense, is disable the autosave, welcome splash page, and etc. And the main thing that is you need to do is you need to enable gflags on the application. You can do either just default gflags or you can use full. Full is just going to give you a full page heap like HPA, and another is a user stack trace. So you can just enable those and start fuzzing. So that way it will add another page in between each memory allocation. So that's going to help you identify out of bound reads, out of bound writes, and all those. So that was target selection, target building. moving on and usage, and what we'll be looking into is corpus. So you selected which application you want to fuzz. You identified how do you want to build it or how do you want to test it. But then what you need input, right? You can't just think about it. You need to actually do something. So finding corpus is the most important thing. The bigger the corpus, the better the results, the better the code coverage many a times. And so there are different ways to get corpus. The easiest one is install the application, see if it gives you any data in the documents folder or inside the C program files directory for that application. If not, if it's a popular format, then you can see if other applications provide that. And if not, then you need to look elsewhere. So where else can you look? So most common is OSS Fuzz by Google. It gives you their own corpus that they maintain, and you can use that. But it's not exhaustive, trust me. So, but that's a good starting place. Apart from that, you can also get fuzzing corpus from several GitHub repositories. So Mozilla over here has given you some corpus for different formats, and you can get corpus from there. And apart from that, you can also do Google Docking. You can just do file type and whichever format you want to use, you can just download, and it will just show you only those files, and you can just keep on downloading as many as you want. But Google is not the only search engine in the world, and there are several others. So you can use DuckDuckGo, Yandex, and Bing. There are several of them. Over here, we can see Yandex. So Yandex, it has a different way of going about it. It uses MIME application instead of file type, but you can still get results. And you can use this for getting some results, which maybe Google might not be giving you. So that is one other way. Wikimedia is another, but it's specifically only for media, but you'll find it's a Google in itself, and you'll find tons of formats, tons of corpus for anything media related that you want to do. And so that's that. But apart from that, we keep on forgetting. Everyone thinks that search engines are the end of the world. They're the start of the world and they're the end of the world. But what we forget is that Google and everything just came about in the year 2000. Internet is there since the 70s, right? So before we had FTP search engines, sorry, we had FTP servers, and there is tons of data on there still, which is not accessed. So luckily for us, there are, like Google, like search engines, we have FTP search engines, and we can utilize those to find several formats which might not be available on Google, because it's not going to be able to cache each FTP link. So that is one place. And the other interesting thing is, for the FTP servers, they don't have any limitation. You can download all the files on there, and it won't just stop at some number or some particular page, which many times Google does. So that is another place where you can find a lot of corpus. I've shown you PDF. You can put OGV, org, any format that you like. If it's there, it will pop up. And this is not the only FTP search engine. There are plenty of them. So that is one way you can find existing corpus, and you can download it, and you can use it for your fuzzing session or for your vulnerability discovery process. And apart from that, you can also do several other tricks. So and let's say you did not find you found a lot of files, then you need to do corpus reduction. Either you reduce the number of files by finding similar files, or you can reduce the file size also, which helps at times. You can use code coverage on the input files and identify as to how much of the code, let's say you found 100 files, how much of the code does it actually cover? Or you need, and then you find 200 files and you say, oh, it's actually covering more code. So I need to keep this as well. But so that is one thing. Apart from that, let's say you did not find a lot of files. You found like 10 files, but you want to fuzz faster and you want to find vulnerabilities quickly. So what I normally do is there are several dumb fuzzers like Radamstar, Zizif, and many others like that. So I just take those initial input files, mutate it a lot with a big margin, and that increases my initial seed count. And then I actually start the fuzzing session. So that way it helps. not necessarily all the time, but most often it helps. There are several tools for all of this, AFL T-Min, AFL C-Min, Foe Minimizer, Peach Fuzz Minimizer, etc. And so this was all related to finding files and playing with it. Along with this, you can also do grammar-based generation. So let's say you know the file format, it's not proprietary, it's the structure is mentioned, like file header, footer, the content, all of that is publicly documented. Then you can just generate files because you know the grammar, the lexer, the parser, the lexer and the grammar. You can create files on the fly and you can fuzz with that. So, but then for that, you need to know the structure or the specification. So over here, we can see a very famous image. Many of you guys, if you're into fuzzing, you must be knowing this. It's AFL, American Fuzzy Lock. Very nice evolutionary fuzzer. It's a evolutionary fuzzer because it's actually doing dumb stuff, but in a smart way. So it's doing dumb fuzzing, but it's actually going back to what it did and, you know, proceeding further. So I'm not going to be explaining what this is because there are many tutorials on how do you go about it. But I'll show you what additional things you can do to enhance this fuzzer or, you know, other variations of this fuzzer. So this fuzzer is a little bit old. The recent version is like 2.63 or something, but yeah. So there are several ways you can go about you, AFL. Some things to enhance it is you use the dirty mode to skip the bit flips and byte flips. Sorry. You go directly to the havoc mode and that will give you faster results, but it might miss out on some of the code coverage. You have custom dictionaries. Let's say you know the file format, what all keywords, what all syntax is used. You can add a custom dictionary. So that way it will make better, smarter files based on the initial input that you have given. And that could increase the code coverage tremendously. Power schedule mode is another for efficient fuzzing. Libdislocator is another library for the page allocation related stuff. Sanitizer options are amazing, and that is the next step because everyone exhausted the basic ones. So sanitizers help you identify more vulnerabilities, but the drawback is it's going to reduce your fuzzing time. Master slave mode is another good thing which I normally use. If you have multi-core systems or if you have one core system, doesn't matter. But you have three fuzzers which are running in tandem, and fuzzer A is providing its data to fuzzer B and C, and C is providing to A and B and vice versa. So let's say one fuzzer is able to generate some files, it will pass that on to the other one, and that will help you. And you just, and what you have to do is you need to build everything with a different sanitizer. You can build one with address, one with memory, one with thread, and run all the different fuzzers on one on each of them, and they will exchange data. And that way, that might get you bugs faster. So reversing is another, I'm just showing the image, I'm not going to be explaining it because it's a whole different thing altogether. But reversing also helps, especially if you want to, like I mentioned before, if you want to reduce the overhead for the processing time, and it will just, you can select which function to close and where to terminate the application and you can proceed further. So that way it will help you. Also in identifying what all formats are supported and what all things are there, if it's closed source, then that will also help you. And also if you're using WinAFL, then that will help you for fuzzing a specific section of the code. So that was fuzzing and a little bit of reversing and how do you find select targets and everything. So the last thing I would like to show you is there are some ways that some people, they think that they are, too smart, or they're plain simply lazy, and they don't want to find, they don't want to spend time fuzzing, they don't want to spend time reversing, they just want to find bugs and report them and then go on finding even more bugs. So is there a way to do that? Yes, there is. So you have open source applications and libraries that come to your rescue, and you have targets like, you know, support and user forums and bug trackers to the rescue. So I'm just going to show you how I found like almost 15 vulnerabilities in a popular product that I think most of you guys have used in your lifetime. and commercial one, and by doing nothing. So if I just go back to my machine, so you guys, I hope you guys can see this. So what I did was, okay, just show you first. So like I mentioned before, the file extensions website. So I think Adam, you can see this, right? Okay, yeah, you guys can see this. So I just searched for PSD because I know that's used by Photoshop. And it is a default application. Okay, so this website tells me that default software to open this format is Photoshop. Click on that. It shows me tons of other formats that it supports. I search for EXR. Okay, bingo. So EXR is supported. Let's click on that. Verify if that is supported. Yes, EXR format can be viewed by Photoshop. Okay, can be opened. Yes, it can be opened by Photoshop. Okay, so the next thing I did was I searched for open source libraries related to this and the EXR format. And I came across this one, so OpenEXR. And this OpenEXR is actively maintained 20 days ago, 17 hours ago. So issues, you just go to issues, closed bugs, and I just search for overflow. Okay, so there are pretty familiar terms, heap user after free, segmentation fault, buffer overflow, heap buffer overflow, and all those. And I just open this. Okay, there is a POC file. Interesting. So the next thing I did was, okay, this is fixed in the open source application, but is it fixed in Photoshop? No. Yes. Let's see. Oh, my bad. I'm just using the debugger to show you guys, and you can also use it without the debugger as well. That's not going to take too much time, so I'm just going to show you after this. Okay. Okay, so it opened Photoshop, okay, and it crashed. I have a first exception. I have a second exception. Okay, we'll leave that to run. It will just take a couple of seconds, a few seconds. This is not just one vulnerability, by the way. There are several. But due to the brevity of time, I'm not going to be able to show you all. So, but you can test it on your own. Okay. Let's just take one other second. Okay, so you see over here invalid pointer, right? So it's an out of bound write, and the symbols are invalid right now because it's closed source and I don't have the symbols. I haven't reversed it. But yeah, it's an out of bound write in this plugin at this particular location, this function at this location, and it's exploitable as per bang exploitable, which is heuristic based, but it works. So, and if you just run this without the debugger, that should crash too. So meanwhile, I'm just going to show you that I found all of these. So these are all just lying there waiting for someone to actually test this in Photoshop and report it. Some out of bound reads, some out of bound writes, again reads, again, right, and right. But then everyone is in a different function, in a different location. So it the code is different. So it needs a different fix. So, okay, I just like that one. Okay, it crashed. So this was just Photoshop crash. So what did I do? I didn't do anything. Normally, I spend time fuzzing, reversing, but in this case, nothing. And I still have vulnerabilities. And for some of them, which were not crashing, you can use that for your fuzzing session. And you can actually fuzz those files, which were already fuzzed, and see if it crashes. And that led to discover 7 of them. So 7 were actually just lying there, and 7 were like that. So basically, it's vulnerability reuse, but it works. And using this, you can find vulnerabilities in multiple products. And yeah, so that's about it. I hand over the mic to the host, Adam.